meet the needs. Some father needs to reconnect with you, Lord. There's a father that's going to come to the door. He just needs to surrender to your will, God. There's a father who don't even feel like he's a father. But Father, give him strength in that weakness, God. Now, Father, we thank you today. And we praise you today. And give us a word today, God. Not an entertainment word, but a word that will search our hearts. A word that will compel us to be better than we were. It's in the powerful name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen, amen, amen.
Say thank you, God. Thank you that we live and move and we have our being in you. Thank you, God, that we sing together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. That we are blessed for all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. And God, we say thank you right now. We don't mind saying glory to your name. We look back to the way you brought us to God. Through every trial and through every tribulation. And sometimes it didn't feel good. Sometimes we had to get up and walk the floor at night. But God, we read in your word, dear God. That no matter whatever we go through, you say everything is working together for good. For those who love you. Those who will call upon to your word. And God, we thank you right now because you are right now, God. And Father, we say glory to your name. Thank you, God, for blessing us to assemble together one more time where we can lift up the name of Jesus in this place. For he said, if I be lifted up, you won't have to do nothing else. I'll do all the drawing. So God, draw them in this morning. Wake them up this morning. Stand down and rule out anything you're not pleased with, Father, in the name of Jesus. And Father, we know that you're here. We welcome your Holy Spirit because you said in your word that if just two or three that we come together in your name, Father, you promise that you'd be in the midst of. So welcome, Holy Spirit. Come on and just have your way today. Have your way in this place. Give us a touch from the master's hand. Just to praise him today. Let us sing unto your glory, dear God. Touch all the musicians, dear God. Touch every seat in the house. Let it be a house seat. God bless all the ministers of your word, dear God. We need a rhema word from you. Oh, in the name of Jesus, let it be a tailor-made word that'll lift up some bowed heads and give peace to some troubled minds, dear God. Let God, let signs and wonders, let it follow your word today. Let someone come crying, what must I do to be saved? Oh, in the name of Jesus, because we believe the word works, because your word is forever settled in heaven. You watch it over your word to perform it right now. So we give you back your word today. In the name of Jesus, all our steps in your word today. Let your word go to every hospital and every convalescent home, every mental institution, every rehab center, every hospice center. And God, let your healing power, according to your perfect will for their lives, let it have free course today. In the name of Jesus. And God, we thank you right now. In the name of Jesus. We don't know what you want to do today, Holy Spirit, but we stand back and we say, have your way today. Come on in the building. Just have your way, dear God. And we thank you right now. But one thing we promise, whatever you do today, we'll give you all the praises. We'll give you all the glory. We'll give you all the honor. But not just in anybody's name. But God, we thank you. There is a name down here in the earth realm. And we found out for ourselves. It's a name that's above every name. There's healing in that name. Burdens are removed in that name. Yokes are destroyed in that name. Strongholds are torn down in that name. There's deliverance in that name. There's healing power in that name right now, God. And God, we thank you right now. In the name of Jesus, the sweetest name that you know. Hey, he's the way maker. He is the miracle worker. He is the promise keeper. He is the light in the darkness. He's the great I am that I am. He's whole now. The only wise God. The true and the living God. The shepherd and the spirit of our soul. Hallelujah. I want to just turn to amen. Can you give God the glory?
So as I always come thanking God and honoring God for the opportunity you know, to speak before his people. But what I wanted to say this morning in encouragement, I always give what God has given me, right? And so I know everybody knows the story of Lazarus. I'm going to be really quickly. When Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead, you know, the sisters, Mary, Martha was telling him, hey, come, my brother is sick, you know, and Jesus said that he was going to wait 2 more days before he came. So I know it's a lot of things people can preach. I'm not going to preach and none of that, but I know it's a lot of things people can preach from this message. But what I want to come from with this scripture, we're going to be looking at John 11, 43 and 44. And just to give you a little bit of background, Jesus had already looked up, told God, thank you, because what he was trying to do with Lazarus to make the people know that Jesus, that God is real, to make believers out of them. So what I want to talk about today is take off the grave clothes. And the scriptures, John 11, 43 and 44, it says, now when he said these things, he cried with a loud voice, Lazarus, come forth. And he who was dead came out bound, hand and foot with grave clothes. And his face was wrapped with a cloth. And Jesus said to them, loose him, and let them go. Amen. Now, notice the point, Jesus called him out with a loud voice. We don't know if it was because he was in the tomb. He was already wrapped up. You know how it be, the mummies, you know, back in the day, they had to wrap the ears, the mouth, everything was just, you know, stripped. So we don't know if he was saying that for the authority of his voice, but because of the crowd that was out there, you know, it was a crowd. Or because he was in the tomb. But whatever we know that when Jesus speaks, we got to move. Whether we're dead or whether we're not, when Jesus speaks, we got to move.
Amen.
And even though he came out of the grave, it says that he was still bound with the grave clothes. And I feel like that's just some of us. You know, God spoke this to me. That's just like some of us. We're not in the darkness anymore, but we still can't see. Came out of the darkness, but you still can't see. You still don't know how to make your way. You know, the path still don't look clear, right? And so that's what he was saying. You know, you're out now, but you're still bound.
Woo!
Free to move. Certain things holding us back. And we're all don't been in a place before where we've been bound. It could have been a bad relationship, but we still hold the residue of that bad relationship. We're in the next one, but now we don't trust. It could have been somebody, you know, who had bills and was, you know, robbing people to pay Paul, like people say. I'm going to pay a little bit on this one, and then I'm holding. We're in a different place now. We got a different mindset. We got to take off the residue, right? We got to take off the old things and put on the new things. Verse 4:4, it reads, and he who died came out bound, hand and foot, with gray clothes, and his face wrapped with the cloth. Jesus said to them, loose him, and let them go. Now, when I looked up grave clothes, it's just a garment in which dead person was wearing. But the grave clothes represent the darkness and the corruption of our old sin nature. The way we think about things and the way we do things. Example, God brings us out of our dark situations, but we hadn't got rid of the residue, the past. And we have a tendency when we get into a new place to kind of sabotage it because of the way we think. If anybody ever came out of something, then you free and this and that, but then you got back into a relationship and you sabotaged the whole relationship because you got the same kind of mindset. Your mindset had changed, your perspective had changed. You got that residue on you, and nothing changed. So that's what I want to talk about. You got to take off the grave clothes. You got to take off that old mindset. You got to take off those things that held you down, those things that
was
representative of the sin, of the things that you was once in. You got to let it go. You got to walk away from it. And sometimes it's our environment. Sometimes it's our people that we hang around. Now, if I was a drinker or a smoker or whatever, I was doing a club and I just wanted to take off that residue, I don't want to do that no more. I can't hang out with the people that did that. So I got to take some of that stuff off. But this is the thing that got me when he said, Jesus said to them, loose them and let them go. He didn't just say a Martha. He didn't just say Mary, go over there and loose your brother. You know, it was the Jews, because the Jews that came to comfort Mary and Martha, right? So they was there, the disciples was there, Jesus was there. So he told them. So and when people come, and we just can't expect the pastor to do it. We just can't expect the pastor to do it. We can't expect mama to do it. We can't expect your boyfriend or your homeboy, your girlfriend to do it. We got to do it. It's a community effort. We all got to help somebody coming in here. They may stink. They may got some stuff on them, you know, because the residue 4 days in the grave. They had already said he was kind of stinky already. So it's kind of stinky stuff that you got to help people get rid of. I got bandages on the back. I mean, I can't see this. I may say, Sandy, can you? You know, what does that look like today? You know, that means we gotta encourage somebody else. We gotta not only encourage people, but we gotta pray for one another. We gotta help people get rid of the residue that they can't see. But sometimes we can't see what's on us, right? But other people can see it so clearly. So we gotta help people to get rid of those things. And I can just imagine Lazarus when he came out. You know how they come out like a mummy. He can't see, but he know Jesus don't call his name. Somebody take this off my face so I can see him, so I can thank him. Somebody release my hand. Take this out of my mouth, I can say thank you, Jesus. You know, I want to hear what he's telling me. I want to listen for the instructions. Oh, I mean, he don't gave me another chance to raise him from the dead after 4 days. So if God has brought us out, what are we saying? What do we want to say? What do we want to do? We don't want to walk around still bound up with all those things that was holding us back. So this is what I want to say. I just want to encourage everybody today to take the gray clothes off. The old ways of thinking, the bad attitudes, the bad self-image, the bad habits, the doubt, the disbelief. It's kind of like people who wear a Band-Aid. If you, a long time ago, we used to go to the doctor, we had to get them shots every so often, and the Band-Aid after about 4 days, you still got the sticky stuff on there. You know, sometimes you put ice on, sometimes you rub ice on it to try to peel it off, it didn't work, and sometimes you wash it, it still didn't work, but after a while, you know that it's gone. After a while, you're going to see the residue of it going away. But it's going to take somebody. It's going to take a community. So when the people are coming in from the outside, coming into the church, we can't just let the pastor do the work. We can't just let the elders and the ministers do the work. It all takes a community of us all doing the work to get rid of that stinky stuff on other people. So I just want to encourage everybody to take the gray clothes off. And if yours is already off, help somebody take it off.
But we don't realize that we're free. And some of us have been so bound in some things that we think the way we're living is the way we're supposed to live. And then when we get free, we don't know what we want. So I want you to do something. I want you to ask somebody next to you. I want you to say, honestly, tell me, what is it that you really, really, really want? And neighbor, I want you to tell them what you really, really, really want. Now tell them you're free to go and get that thing. You're free to have that. You're free to walk in that. You're free to experience that. It don't matter what it is. Joy, love, hey. And here's something else. When the word says he gives you the desires of your heart, the actual desires, the wants that you have, God placed those in you. So the reason you want it is because God caused you to want it. So he's not just giving you what you want. He gave you the want that you have for it. Amen. I'll give God some praise.
Final say. Thank you. Thank you. And yes, a miracle is still on the way. So my father moved to the East Coast, and my mother continued to raise me, and she remarried, so I do have a stepfather. But I didn't really talk to my biological father very much. He was in the fruit of Islam, a different religion. And so to connect with him when I was an adult, I tried to go to Savior's Day, but it wouldn't work. Because there's something about Jesus. How many of you ever heard someone say there's something about the name Jesus? Hey! And so I couldn't get with that, but it pleased him that I went. Long story short, I basically grew up without him. But I grew up strong. And I put myself into my studies very hard to compensate for a lot of things that I was missing. I read a lot of books for a lot of the things that I was missing from him, because I wanted him to know me and I wanted to know him. But I praise God for my upbringing. I praise God for wonderful maternal uncles that love me. They are the kings of my heart. I praise God for them, for a stepfather. But there came a time when my biological father grew ill, and I was probably in my 40s at that time. And so my aunts who were there in the New York and DC area, they phoned me up. And so I still had a love for this man, though I didn't know him. So I heard everything and it's no help. So then I called the hospital. And the hospital says, well, we didn't know he had a daughter. So we're not talking to anyone else anymore. We have to talk to you.
Yeah.
Long story short, doctors called me that day. Several doctors called me. And they said that he was brain dead. He was not alive. They could keep him alive until I fly up there. What a decision and what a choice I had to make for someone I barely knew. But let me say this. I made the decision. They did what they had to do medically. Funeral plans were made and I went to his funeral. And for someone I never knew, I knew he was my father, and I knew that he gave me life.
Yes.
So some of you today, there are fathers that gave you life.
Yes.
And they're not in your life, and they've never been in your life. But God was my father. Wonderful uncles, a stepfather, a brother. Amen. I cried some. Oh, did I ever cry and mourn. But I just washed those tears away, and God bound every one of them because he healed my hurt. And God told me they were young. And I had to learn how to forgive. Forgive my lack of understanding, not forgive them, because they did the best. And so I just thank God that even though I made that decision and I buried my father, and he was buried with dignity, but I also buried that past. That day when he was buried. So I want to encourage you, if you're a young lady or young man, please know that God was my father. I would write to him so often. I have journals from years and decades gone by. But just know that the Heavenly Father has you. So that is why I have a closer relationship with him, because I did not know that in the natural. So he is my father. And I thank God for every man that is here, for every man that has taken up the slack for what someone else didn't do. Happy Father's Day to you too. My great-grandfather, Elder Van Buren, he had a saying. Daddy is the man that takes care of you. So I'm not telling you to forget your fathers, but also honor those men that have taken up the slack and that have loved you as fathers. Amen. So I'm going to move forward now. I'm just so excited to be here today. I just get excited when I come into the palace. We're going to actually present some gifts for the fathers. But the first thing I'd like to do is call up everyone that is here to give a tribute. We're going to call up China, Rihanna, and then Sir William. They will come in that order.
Good morning, everyone.
Good morning.
I just want to say some nice things about my dads, because I have like three of them. I have my bonus dad, my stepdad back there, and then I have my other dad right here. They're all so great to me. They protect me. They keep me focused and keep me driven. Pastor called me and be like, "What's going on? What you doing? What you got going on? You still in school? You doing good?" And one thing about me and Pastor, we actually share the same birthday. So every year we have something to celebrate. And he always like, you know, what we gonna do on our birthday? So we always have to figure that out. And then with my bonus dad, I love you.
Aww.
Love you so much. He really stand in the gap when I don't have nobody else.
Woo!
He stands in the gap.
Thank you.
And I don't have to say.
Today I'm here to tell y'all how exceptional and meaningful my father is to be. My father really sets a great example of how I would like to be to my kids. He's hardworking, loving, caring, persistent. He's my number one fan, my number one supporter, but he's also my number one critic. He's just always been there for me for everything, whether it's just been practices, games, anything going on at school, appointments, all of it. Gets up early every single day just to go out and provide for me and my sisters. He always makes sure that I have what I need and what I want, because clothes on my back, food on the table, a roof over my head, shoes on my feet, and I can't think of nothing. Yeah, you the real
right. Thank you, Sir William. So William is an athlete, and he is a super duper basketball star.
Yes, he is.
And then at this time, we're going to give a gift bag to all the fathers that are here. I know Minister Felicia, Minister Shannon. We're going to make sure all you fathers in the house, thank you for being here. And on the behalf of the Palace of Praise, you are loved and you are appreciated. So let the fathers receive their gifts at this moment. Please stand if you are a father. Please stand. Hallelujah. Look at all these fathers. Happy Father's Day to you. Thank God for all you do. Thank God for all you've been through. Thank God for working. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Taking care of your families, your children, your wife. Thank you all so very much. We love you with the love of the Lord. We appreciate you. And we respect you on this day to our dear fathers. Thank you. Thank you so very much. Hallelujah. We reach the fathers. Praise God. Praise God. So we've reached every man. Thank God for you. Thank God for you. Let's give the fathers a hand clap at this time. We'd like to acknowledge special fathers in our midst. Elder Brooks, leave. Okay? Pastor Brooks, Pastor Brooks, happy Father's Day to you. And there's this man in here, this young man in here. I try to get him started sometimes when I say, go ahead, Pops. But look, I just love Pops. Pops, Pops. I thank God for you. He got excited while we were in praise and worship. I mean, something about him, the way he loves to praise the Lord. His name is Pastor E.Z. McDuffie. So, Angie Banks is the one that introduced us to the palace. So, we were there and Pastor was preaching and I nudged her. I said, is it like this every Sunday?
Yeah.
And she said, yup. I said, woo, like that. So, I was still in Louisiana. Long story short, I am here in the great state of Texas. Now, the palace means a great deal to me because I receive deliverance here, I receive encouragement here, and I receive love here. So, Pastor, when I say thank you, I thank you also thanking God above for you.
Yeah, yeah.
Amen. Some, you know, I'm just gonna tell you because this Father's Day, right? There are times when once I move here, because I got a church before I got a job. And so did Lisa. And I've said this before, but when the Lord does something for you, you don't mind saying it over again. And baby, I go to work and I try to look at the palace on the way going to work, honey. And then when the big trucks would get in the way, I would get so frustrated just to see this holy and anointed place where I got deliverance and freedom over here.
Yeah.
But to my pastor, I appreciate you. He's spoken into my life, the lives of my children. He's encouraged me. There's some scripture in Kings, and I've been reading it. And there was, you remember when Sheba visited King Solomon? And see, I heard things, you know, just like Sheba did. She heard it through the grapevine, amen. But I heard things. But when I got here, I experienced it for myself. And I thank you, Pastor, for everything. He is our shepherd. He is our father. He has such wisdom. And half of it wasn't even told. And I'm walking in it, Pastor. And I'm experiencing it, Pastor. So let's give Pastor a hand. Hallelujah. Thank you for the name of God. Hallelujah.
and love to you. We thank you for being a father, a big brother, an irritating friend sometimes. But we love him most importantly because he is our shepherd. And even though we sometimes don't be good sheep, he's still a good shepherd to us. Oh, come on, you can do better than that. You know how we get an attitude when we show up. You know how we get an attitude when we don't want to love you. But guess what? He still extends his arm and love on us as a good shepherd. So we pray that you enjoy this wonderful token of love from the entire church family. We love you, and there's no more better pastor we can ask for than this man of God right here. Thank you so much. We love you. Come on, tell him we love you, Pastor.
Lord God, those things that we can't see, Lord God, those things, Lord God, that are happening, Lord God. want you to do that. We don't see you doing it, Lord God. But we know that you are working behind the scenes. So no matter what the need is on today, Lord God, no matter what the prayer is on today, Lord God, you hear all of us at one time. That's just how awesome God you are, Lord God. Your hands are not so short that you can't reach down and touch us, Lord God. Your ears are not close up that you cannot hear us, Lord God. And I thank you, Lord God, that you just hear all of our prayers and have heard to us the sweet aroma, Lord God. Some of us don't have a need right now, Lord God, but what we want to do is
still believe that one touch from God can change your situation. I still believe when you go back to the doctor will be amazed what the Lord has done for you. I still believe that your son and daughter, no matter what they are, no matter what they're doing, they're going to prophesy. I still believe that I'm the head and not the tail. I still believe that God is able to finish what he started. I still believe that the church has some power. I still believe that if you call the name Jesus, if you call that name, demons will flee. Call the name, call his name. Beautiful sight, you see?
Yeah.
When kings take their place,
yeah.
No way. Well, Boy Rogers, I want somebody to go get Boy Rogers. He's coming. Bring him down here. When kings take their place, things begin to happen. Man get in the place that God has ordained him to be in. Houses become under control. I'm getting ready to pray. I want every woman in this house to stand to your feet. They say that men are an endangered species. I believe that God is going to finish everything he started.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
I don't believe. I don't believe. I don't believe he brought you this far.
No, sir.
To lead you. To lead you now. So, Father, I pray in the name of Jesus. Ladies, I need you to pray. Something about women. The women of God begin to pray for the men of God.
Woo!
Miracles begin. Nobody knows the struggle that some men go through. Trying to hold it all together. And sometimes feeling like your best is just not good enough. We talk about God. We say God can do anything. But today, I'm asking every lady in this house to open up your mouth and say, Lord, do it for them. Some house need a man to stand where he needs to be. Some marriage is in trouble right now. Some brother's about to give up and walk away. Some brother's still struggling. Some brother here is still dealing with the addiction of relapsing. But today, Father, we come to the altar. And we give it all to you today. We as men don't like to be entertained. If it can happen, God, let it happen for me. Father, you said I can actually prove this. This morning, I pray in the name of Jesus Christ
prove yourself. And everything that the devil meant for bad, turn it around right now. Father, today we deal with the hurt, that little boy who was hurt. That little boy felt abandoned. The little boy who made a mistake that can't get over his mistake. Today, Father, I pray that your healing power would move all throughout this sanctuary today. There's a king in there, God. Wake that king up. He's been asleep too long, God. Give him his identity back. Let him know, Father, he is a child of the Most High God. And let him know that, Father, serving you does pay off, God. We don't have to be emotional like everybody else. We don't have to jump. But Father, we do have to acknowledge that you are the King of Kings. And you are the Lord of Lords. So today, Father, I pray for my brother. I pray that, Father, you would give him strength. Come on, ladies, you time right now. Come on, strength to him, too. Father, I pray in the name of Jesus that brothers will heal. Issue will not be your name. You are a child of God. Your steps are ordered by God. Today, in the name of Jesus, I bind every spirit. Don't step in and go. I bind every spirit that will try to take your life. I pray in the name of Jesus, God, that your mistake will never identify who you are. In the name of Jesus, you are covered by the blood. No evil can come your dwelling. You will not be another statistic. You will not be another number. When God made you, brother, he knew what he was doing. He did not make a mistake. And I pray that the power of God will be inside of you. Holy Ghost, have your way. That keeping power, that deliverance power, that breakthrough power will stand strong inside of you. Now, Father, I bind anything. Because you come that we might have life and have it abundantly. But you told us the devil comes to kill, steal, and destroy. So we cancel the art. Touch not my anointed. Do the prophet no harm. Cover, seal, protect. It's in the powerful name of Jesus Christ that we pray. Now, for just one moment, I want every lady to sit down. I want you to hear this sound. I want every man at this altar for one moment. God said he heard you at a football game. He heard you at a basketball game. He heard when you celebrated somebody else. Just for one moment, I want every man at this altar to celebrate God. And on three, we're going to celebrate God for 1 minute. And we're going to let ladies hear when men praise their God. How it sounds. One, two, three. Thank you. in the name of Jesus Christ, let it be done this day. Amen. Come on, give God a hand. Let's celebrate God. Let's celebrate God. Amen. I need every son to be father.
Amen.
Can we take a moment to celebrate my daughter Myra's in the house? Come on, let's celebrate. I mean, man, let's celebrate her. Don't look like what you don't. Amen. I call her my Marilyn Monroe. Amen. It's good to be in the house. Now look, they've already told me, you know, saying, now listen, Pastor, it's Father's Day.
Yeah.
Amen. They gotta get y'all there. You know, Mother's Day, you go to state houses and all that. But Father's Day, we end up at CCPC. Granddad to get to try out a new dish, you know, and stuff like that. So today I'm going to get you out of time. But, you know, I'm at a place in my life I'm just feeling so different about delivering the word of God. You know, I just feel like that, you know, we've had enough motion, we had enough hollering and screaming. You know, I want to see some results.
Amen.
I would not, come on, I would not be able to stand and minister to you if I didn't believe that the word of God works.
Yes.
I'm telling you that your posture has to be that the word of God works. I say it works. Last night I got a text from a woman of God about the really praying when she's been going through cancer and stuff like that. And she had decreed and declared this. She had made her own self a message and she played. She sent it to me and I was listening to her. She was reminding God about the scripture. You said that I am healed by the stripes of Jesus.
Yeah.
You said no sickness can come my dwelling. Father, I stand up on that. And she, for 10 minutes, I was listening to that about 3 o'clock in the morning. And God said, that's when we got to get to believing what I say.
Woo! Yeah.
Sometimes we tell God what we experience. But God said, I'm not worried about what you experience. Otherwise, it's going to end. And the Bible said, and we know in the end, somebody said, we're going to win this. So today, I was just looking at what can I talk to men? Because, you know, women, you can get away with the entertainment. But when brothers come, they're like, hey, they look at you, hey, come on, man, what you got to say, you know? So I was just thinking about, I said, God, show me the characteristics of a godly father. And I begin to ponder that thing. What is the characteristics of a godly father? Now I know what the characteristics of a father is, you know, to be a provider to people, but what is a godly father? What's the characteristics of a godly father? And God took me right here, and I don't have to be very long. Let's go to Luke 15. Let's look at 21 through 24. The characteristics of a godly father. Let's stand to our feet. Let's get ready to read together. Amen. Now listen, if you can't stand, that's okay. We don't flip my stuff like nobody gonna come give you a ticket. Then if somebody look at you and say, I'm sick, so what you gonna do? Somebody said the characteristics of a godly father. Now listen. We heard this story so many times, and God just took me back to the prodigal son. How many times have we heard that story? And I was just looking at the prodigal son. Look at verse 21. Let's read it together. And the son said what? Unto him, Father, I have what? Sinned against what? Now listen,
Now listen, now this is after he coming home. This is the prodigal son. Yes. He, the son said unto him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and what?
And thy sight.
And what?
And thy sight.
And what? And I am
no more worthy to call
God. Now listen, look at the humility now. Mm-hmm. I want you to hear me. Life will teach you some lessons that a father can never teach you.
Yes, that's right. Yes, sir.
For those who are struggling with their kids, life will teach you lessons that me saying something could never get to you. How do I know? Because it dealt me some blows too. Okay, verse 22. But the father said to the said what? Bring forth what?
The best robe.
Now listen, say the best robe.
The best robe.
And what?
And put
what?
The ring on his hand.
And what?
Shoes on his feet.
Verse 23. And bring here the what?
Fatty calf.
Say a fatty calf. And what?
Slaughter.
Some say slaughter, some say kill. And let us what?
Eat it.
And what?
And be merry.
Now this is the good part here. For my son was what?
Dead.
But what?
He's alive again.
All right, but alive again. Take a seat, take a seat. Are you praying for me?
Yes.
If you're going to be a godly father, there is one thing that every father has to have, and somebody say compassion.
Compassion.
You got to be concerned about the sufferings of others. Now listen, I love the scripture because when the father saw the son coming, Pastor Freeman, he didn't wait for the son to get to him. He went to the son. Amen, amen, amen. And we're talking today because I really believe that what the church is missing is compassion.
Yeah.
Now I want you to look at me. We all have sin.
Yeah.
I don't care how good the person on the side of you look right now. We all have sin at one time or another.
Yeah.
It took Jesus Christ to save us all. So if you're going to be a godly father, help me, Holy Ghost, you got to have compassion.
Yeah.
Because I talked about life. Life has a way of treating you that will make you go back home.
Yeah.
Yes, it will.
Yeah.
I can talk over and over about this prodigal son because the prodigal son had went through a whole lot.
Oh, yeah.
See, life has a way of teaching you some things. The Bible says when he was going through, one day he came to his senses.
Yeah.
Every father in here, you ought to know that one day that somebody out there that you're praying for, that somebody that you believe in God to bring deliverance to, one day they're going to come to their senses.
I don't care
because one day I came to my senses.
Yeah.
And if we can get out of the way of trying to judge everybody.
All right.
Looking at what they've gone through and what they did and start remembering they home now.
Yeah. Yeah.
What happens once they get home?
All right.
Amen.
I look at people who keep record of everything that somebody has done.
All right.
And not knowing that everybody has that one day. That one day when God redirects you. That one day when God let everything dries up and they have to go back home. So the question is, what happens when they come back home? I love this because it shows the love of the Father, the compassion of the Father. He runs to the Son. This is what messed me up. I'm close with this here. And when he runs to his Son, he embraces his Son. He kissed his son.
Yeah.
Now listen, the kiss came before the confession. He wasn't worried about what you did and what you our mess. God did not wait for us to get perfect. The Bible says, while we were yet sinners, Christ died for all of us. So what kind of father are you? You gotta have a father that has compassion.
Yes.
And the reason why we're losing so many people, because we're keeping notes on everything that somebody did.
Help us, Pastor.
I'm not focused on where you've been. My job is to redirect you where you go. And I want somebody to say, I'm on my way somewhere. The Bible says that the steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord. And this is the challenge of the church, because I talk to people over and over again. We don't have compassion for nobody. We want to talk about everything somebody did. We want to look them up and down. We want to talk about what they got on. Why not look at it a different way? Saying they were dead, but now they are alive. So not only are you to have sympathy for somebody, be concerned about somebody that's suffering.
Yeah.
I was looking down at somebody else saying, I'm glad I'm not like them. The only reason that you're not like the person that you see on the street is because of the love of God.
Yeah.
I wish I had somebody to be honest up in here, say, I've done some things I should have been cut off. I said some stuff. If God was keeping record of everything I did, I wouldn't be able to be in this church today. To hear more.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. So brothers, I want to talk to you. Just have the compassion.
Yes, sir.
Never, my mama told me, never look down on somebody.
That's right.
When you drive by the man on the street,
my God,
just remember, that's somebody's son.
Yes.
That's right.
Yes, sir.
When you look back and you talk about how he looks, but you, what about the mothers at home praying for her son?
Yeah.
You gotta have compassion. When Jesus saw the people, he looked at them, he had compassion, because he said, these are our people without a shepherd.
Yes, sir.
I don't need notes for this here. I want to talk to you today. What are the characteristics?
Right.
Not just looking good.
All right.
Not just saying I'm the man.
Yes,
well, if you're the man, then you ought to show that you're the man. All the way you can be the man, you got to be aligned with a God. And, oh, I wish I had somebody.
Yes,
that's my first one. Say compassion. Someone say compassion.
Compassion.
Yes.
Have you lost your compassion?
Mm-hmm. My God.
Have you forgot that the Bible says the whoremongers, fornication, lies, and adulterers, so are you?
Yeah.
I know you look good this morning.
Yep.
I know you got your shah ba 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 and all that there. You speak in tongues, you can be deep and all that.
Yes.
But have you forgot where you came from?
Oh, my God.
Have you forgot about what God has done for you? I was talking to a minister one day, and he was saying, well, Pastor, I cannot get to my son. I said, the reason you can't get to your son, because you acting like you holy all your life. Don't you talk about what you can't do? You talk about how he looks, but it wasn't even 20 years ago, you were in that same place. That same place that you see him in, that's where you were in. You don't look down. Sometimes you gotta tell him, I've been at the same place you've been.
Yeah.
And I can tell you that it's going nowhere. But when I turned and gave myself back to God. The characteristics of a God man, he restores.
Yes.
Come on. Are you restoring?
Yeah.
My God.
God has given you the power to restore.
Yes.
Come on. It's up to you to get in your rightful place.
Yes.
If the house is out of order, restore order.
Yes.
But you cannot restore order when you are out of order.
Come on, Pastor.
Somebody say restore.
Restore.
You be the one that's praying.
Yeah.
Yes, sir.
You gotta be the one that's leading your family to church.
Yes.
Yes.
You cannot be a godly father just sitting at home and then when your kids and your wife come home, how was church today? You should have been at church.
Yes. Yes.
Yes. Yes.
And it's time for us to just have this little talk.
Yeah.
It's time for us to examine, restore.
Yes.
You cannot be a godly father without restoring the honor.
Yes. That's right.
Amen. Amen.
Just like I got an honor for my house, yes. Guess what? My kids know the honor of my house.
Yes.
There are things that you don't do in my house.
Yes.
There are some people just can't come in my house.
All right.
You restore.
Yes, sir.
And allow God to do what he needs to do in your life.
That's
right. So I'm asking you, if we're going to see this great move of God,
yes, sir.
We've got to have the attitude that how you are now, you're not going to always be like that.
That's right.
I love when they was going up the prayer and they grabbed the man by the hand and said, you're not going to stay in this condition. You gotta have some power that when you open up your mouth, you know that the God that you serve will back you up.
Yeah, that's it.
Come on, I need some brothers that lift up your hands and say, we about to get the thing in order right here.
All right.
Amen. Amen. Come on, say restore.
Restore.
Yeah. So I look at this here. I look at this because the passage really dealt with me because the boy had messed up. He got all, he told daddy, give me what's mine.
Yeah.
He went out, he spent it,
yeah.
He done all the crazy stuff, but one day everything ran out and he came to his senses.
Yeah.
And he decided to go back home to be lesser than what he was.
Right.
Yeah. All right.
He said, I can go back to my father's house. Listen, brothers, if you don't hear nothing else, I've got to say, I don't care if you got kids, always leave the door open.
Yeah.
Oh, I wish I had somebody. I wish I had somebody real quick. Say, leave the door open.
Yeah.
Now listen.
Yes, sir.
Listen what he did.
All right.
He restored. When the boy came back, he restored one thing. He restored was his identity.
Yeah.
Sometimes we forget who we are.
Yeah.
Amen.
Sometimes we start acting like other people.
Yeah.
Uh-huh.
Doing what they do. Some say, again, identity. You got to let people know who they are in God.
Yes.
Amen.
The father restored the boy's identity. He said, listen, I just rather go, since I'm sinning against you, I'd rather just go be with the slave. He said, no!
No!
Yes. You're my son! I'm going to say it one more time. Help me say, no!
No!
You are my son! No, you're not going to be a slave.
Right.
No, you're not going to be a servant.
Uh-uh.
I'm going to give you your identity back.
Yes!
He tells him, go get me a robe.
Yes!
Come on, say a robe.
No.
I need to give you your identity back.
Yeah.
And that's what we need to do in the church. Instead of preaching all these sermons about what you can have, we got to preach some sermons about who you can be.
Yeah.
Tell us the identity.
Identity.
I love this woman of God because I want to make sure I take my time because he said, listen here, I've got to redress him.
Yeah.
Because slaves were barefooted. No, go get me some sandals.
Yes.
Look how he's restoring Pastor Free. Go get me a robe. Go get me a sandal. Because guess what? I've got to give him his royalty priesthood back.
Yes.
I got to put him back in right standing.
Yes.
So he gives him his identity back. But then he also gives him his dignity back.
Yes.
Someone say dignity.
Dignity.
I I told my son, I was telling him, I said, listen, like, don't you forget, you represent me.
Come on. Yeah.
And how you look
right.
represents me.
Yes.
I don't care about no Tupac, no Biggie Smalls. Guess what? All this stuff you putting on your shirt don't represent who I am.
Yes.
Y'all got quiet on there.
Yeah.
You gotta tell them, you gotta give them their identity back. You gotta give them, say identity. You gotta give them who they are in Christ.
Yes.
Amen.
And I can preach this over and over again. Come on, somebody say identity. Who are you?
Yes, yes.
Not who you trying to be.
Who are you?
Who are you in Christ?
Yes.
And if you don't know who you are in Christ, then guess what? You're going to end up, I'm going to tell you, in a pig pen one day.
Yeah.
Come on. All right.
So this is what I'm looking at this here. I'm reading this here sermon. I'm studying. And God said, the problem is we don't give people their identity. We tell them more about you can have cars and houses.
Yeah.
What about tell them they can just have me? As long as they got me, guess what? They have all that they need.
Yeah.
Come on. Give them that dignity back. I don't care how she look when she come in. She don't have to stay that way. You can change what you see if you pray in the right way. Change what you see.
Yeah.
If you pray in the right way.
Yes.
I'm getting ready to close.
Hello.
But I want you to understand this. I'm just tired of just seeing us go through the motions.
Yes.
I'm tired of us. We saying what God can do. Brothers, if you get in your wife a place, guess what?
Yes.
Things can begin to happen.
Yes.
You got to know who you are and whose you are.
Yes.
You got to know if God be for you, he's more than the world against you. You got to know, I don't care what they're doing, me and God can do this all by ourselves.
Yes,
yes,
yes, Lord.
Oh, yes.
He gave his identity back. He gave him his dignity back.
Yeah.
He redressed him in. He gave him his authority back.
Yes.
That ring represented authority.
Yes.
Put a ring on his finger. That means you can still do business as the family.
Yeah.
When you put that stamp there, that's the stamp of my approval.
Yeah.
And I want to know, brothers, where's the authority?
All right.
How can you say that you are have a characteristic of a godly man and the devil just can come up in your house?
Yeah.
How can you say that God is ahead of your life and your whole house is out of control? How can you say God is in control when your mind is everywhere?
Yes.
Help us. So I just want to talk for 2 more minutes and I'm done. Somebody say dignity.
Dignity.
Say authority.
Authority.
But see, you cannot get to that point. He restored this boy back and brought him back into fellowship. But you cannot bring a person back into fellowship if you don't remember where you were.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
Somebody say,
I remember.
Come up here, man. Come up here, pops. Give me one more brother. I want you to see this. I feel that.
Okay.
Tell me where you came from and what God did for you.
He's done everything for me.
No, don't be specific.
Bless me. Everything. It's nothing.
He delivered me from 23 years of being locked up to nothing.
I will not talk.
Well, he delivered me from being a great father because, like somebody said earlier, we had examples from my neighborhood, and one of them was my grandfather. So between his plan and God's plan, I'm able to be a great father.
Come on now.
Yeah. The reason I'm doing this is because even though we dressed up,
even
though we look good, we all have been through something.
Yeah.
And what I love what Aaron said because see some of us we can't
get our testimonies over because we're too embarrassed to say what we did. Yeah. When you see me standing here, I'm not standing here trying to impress you. I'm standing here because I know what God did for me and what he brought me from and what he delivered me from. I have always been great. I have always been holy. So when I think about what God did for me, how he brought me out of some situation, my whole soul gets excited about what God has done for me. It makes me want to jump. It makes me want to holler. It makes me want to scream. I want you to feel this today. You see pops dressed up and looking good. But I remember when mama used to be praying for pops. And pops was doing everything up under the sun. And they were saying nothing could happen for pops. But let me tell you the testimony that I can remember in my heart. Pops has a little grandkid. And when pops was doing his thing, I was still kind of doing my thing too. But we were in church still. I was in church. And one day, I'll never forget, his little grandbaby came to the altar. And the pastor driver said, "What do you want God to do?" "I want God to save my grandpa." Wait a minute. So I called Pops on the phone. I said, "Pops?" "Look here, Pops.
Yeah.
I know you've been doing a whole lot of stuff.
Yeah.
But these children are praying now.
Yeah.
And I know it does pray." I said, "That baby just asking God to save her papa." And then Pastor Crow was saying, "Do you believe he can do it?" I want everybody to stand on their feet. And they started praying and believing God. And one day, out of the clear blue sky, we all in church. Church, Pat could have been through some stuff, but guess what? When he came in the church, guess what? The church started praying and going up, and guess what? Pat's been in church ever since then. I wish I had somebody to open up your mouth and begin to pray and say, "I believe that if I pray, something will happen up in this house." Come on up here, Alex. Come on, up here. Come on. I don't believe y'all getting it.
Thank you, Lord.
I don't believe y'all getting it. I'm showing you the characteristics of a godly man, but I'm showing you some men that went from being ungodly to godly.
She missed her Papa's funeral.
I said, I can't do this no more. Mm-hmm. I walked in that hospital room on a Tuesday evening. Yeah. And I was relieving my wife at that time. And I walked in there and I said, Crystal, tonight.
Tonight.
I said, we're going to do something and we're going to get you delivered tonight.
Amen.
I started at about 7 o'clock. And I said, Crystal, fold the napkin. She looked at the napkin, she give it right back to me. I say, Crystal, fold the napkin.
Yeah.
9 o'clock, the nurses come in. They looking at me like I'm Willy Fufu. I say, Crystal, fold the napkin. She look at the napkin, she give it back to me. 11 o'clock, they come in again. I'm still sitting there. And I'm saying, Crystal, fold the napkin. 3 o'clock in the morning, they still come in. I say, Crystal, fold the napkin.
My God.
8 hours Woo! Later.
8 hours. Yeah.
8 hours. How many of y'all can pray for 8 hours?
Hey.
How many of y'all can believe for 8 hours?
Thank you, God.
8 hours, I handed her this napkin. She handed it back to me. I handed her this napkin. She handed it back to me. I handed her this napkin. She handed it back to me. I handed her this napkin. She handed it back to me. I handed her this napkin. She handed it back to me. Can we do that for 8 hours?
Yeah. Oh my God.
She finally took that napkin.
Yeah.
She looked at me. She looked up at me and she looked back at the napkin. I said, Crystal, it's getting late, baby. Just fold the napkin.
Yes.
Just fold the napkin.
Yes.
She looked at it. She took it.
Woo!
Got another fight. And she got another fight. After she folded the napkin, I said, it's done.
Woo!
We're getting out of here. We're leaving this place. It had been 4 months. Almost 4 months. She had been in the hospital room. Tear rehabilitation. They didn't think she could do it. The lady walked in the next morning and said, well, Crystal, what are we going to do today? I said, Renee. I think her name was Renee, if I remember correctly. I said, Crystal's going to walk today.
Yeah.
Oh, no, Mr. Driver. I said, yes, Crystal's going to walk today. This very day, Crystal's going to walk. Oh, no, we can't do that. We can't. I said, get whoever you need to get in here, whatever administrator you need to get you whatever papers I need to sign, Crystal is going to walk today. No, she did. I said, you want to see it? I got it on video.
Yeah.
All right.
So they said, I said, no. Better yet, this is what we're going to do. I said, you bring that wheelchair in the hall, in this room. You put it by this bed. I said, Crystal's going to get in the wheelchair. And when she get in the wheelchair, we're going to take her out in the hall. And Crystal's going to walk today.
Yes.
Hallelujah.
They brought the wheelchair in, put it by her bed. I said, Crystal, baby, we folded the napkin last night. I need you to get in this wheelchair.
Yeah.
I need you to sit. She couldn't even sit up.
You spoke it.
She could not sit up by herself.
My God.
I say, Crystal, I need you to get in this wheelchair, baby, so we can go out in this hall. And we're going to walk today. I say, I've been here all night long. I got all day today.
Yeah.
I don't care how long it takes. We're going to forget about therapy. We're going to forget about this. We're going to forget about that. We're going to get in this wheelchair, and you're going to walk today.
Yeah.
Crystal looks at the wheelchair. She looks up at me. I say, I got time. She looks at the wheelchair, she looks up at me. She sit up.
My God.
Woo!
She grabbed the handle of the wheelchair and she started scooting herself.
My God.
I said, here we go.
Here we go.
I say, really, put her in the wheelchair. She got in the wheelchair, we took her out in the hall. They had to put a little platform thing on her feet so she could walk. She had a little infection. I say, I got back and I got my camera. I started getting ready. Y'all wonder why I didn't shout and turn cartwheels? Because I knew God was fixing to do it.
Yeah.
I had no doubt in my mind. I had seen it over the years how my father had prayed for people and people had gotten up and walked and done this. And I've seen legs grow.
Yeah.
And y'all can believe me if you want to believe it. You don't have to believe it. I seen it with my own two eyes. That's how I knew Crystal could walk.
Yeah.
That's how I knew she was going to walk that day.
Yeah.
No doubt in my mind. None whatsoever.
Thank God.
And I still have that same faith.
Come on.
I still have that same faith.
Yeah.
Nobody tell me no different.
Yeah.
So they took her out in the hall. She was sitting in the wheelchair. The lady stood right there in front of her and handed her, put her hands out. Crystal grabbed her hand
and stood up.
Yeah.
When she stood up, she looked at herself. She looked down like this here. And she started picking her feet up like this. She started picking her feet up like this. So the lady started backing up. And when the lady started backing up, Crystal, start moving forward. Crystal, start moving forward. Crystal walked that day. They didn't believe it. They couldn't believe it. But I had all the faith in the world. Because I know God is able. Beyond the shadow of a doubt, I know God is able. There is no situation, none whatsoever, that's too bad. None whatsoever. None whatsoever. None whatsoever. None whatsoever. None whatsoever. No situation. Dead, but I don't say half dead. I say half alive. No situation. If they say they brain dead, it don't matter. If they say you got 4-stage cancer, it don't matter. None of it matters because God is able. God is able. None whatsoever doesn't matter. There's nothing that looks too bleak. Nothing. Nothing. My father, I seen it over and over and over. Years and years and years of it. I could not believe anything different. I can't today believe anything different. And you can't tell me anything different. God is able. Amen.
Crystal, I want you to stand up real quick. Man. I want you to give God a praise for Crystal right now. Crystal been graduating in college. Come on here. Now listen here. I know time. It's full spirit now. Can we celebrate? Can we celebrate? Now listen here. I got a cold. I feel a little bit slow. I feel like preaching now. And then the daddy said, my son was dead, but now he is alive. I want you to look at your neighbor and say, neighbor, it's not dead. It's still alive. And what God is looking for is somebody in here to open up your mouth and say, it's not going down like this. That's my child. That's my promise. And my promise will not die. I need 10 people up in here. This life been messed up. Throw your hands up. I'm still alive. I go, I'm been through. Come here, Mara. Come here, that last one right quick. I'm your pastor. I'm your pastor. And I talked to God about you. And God told me to tell you that he's getting ready to give you a testimony. You've been giving him glory. You've been giving him praise. And God said he's getting ready to show the world what he can do. And God's getting ready to heal. Somebody point your hand this way. Heal right now in the name of Jesus Christ. I pray right now in the name of Jesus that your body is healed by the stripes of Jesus Christ. And no weapon formed against you is going to prosper. And God's going to give you a double for all your trouble. For every time you had to cry. For every time you went through. For every time you want to go in the car. Your strength was made perfect because God was in you, pushing you. You won't be able to lay hands on somebody else. They will be here. I want this church on this Father's Day. There's some fathers in this house that's got compassion to pray for your kids. There's some fathers that's in this house that say everything that God has promised me is going to come to pass. I want some brothers to start waving your hand and say it's going to happen. lift it up.
We'll be right back.
things. You didn't get nothing from the message today. You gotta have compassion. I brought people up here because sometimes we act like that when you see somebody, you don't know what's really inside of it. And you know, I look at my life all the time, and I just break down. And Jack, I break down because I know where I've been.
Yes.
And I know where God brought me out of. I tell people, I'm not trying to impress anybody. Listen, I know what God did for me.
Yes.
And I reflect over it over and over again. I remember that suicidal spirit that I was fighting with, and they were trying to get me to take my life, and God sent a preacher at about 2 o'clock in the morning, 3 o'clock in the morning, knocking on the door to pray. I'll never forget that. I'm telling you that we got to get in position. We got to get to the point that we are restoring people, not tearing them down. The prodigal son and the prodigal daughter, they know where they've been. Stop talking about where they've been. Take a moment to tell somebody where you're going. Look at your name and say, you're going somewhere. I don't care who's walked out of your life, I don't care who's left you. You are going somewhere. I don't care if you're there your last time. You open up your mouth and you declare, I'm going somewhere. God has blown my mind. We look at other people and we marvel about them. Let's marvel about what God has done in your life. When that prodigal son came back home, listen, you want people to say all that? I'm sorry, no. Give them love. Love covers a multitude of sin. God didn't wait for you to get perfect. While you were yet in your mess, God forgave you for your sins through Jesus Christ. Stop making it hard for the prodigal son and daughter to get back home. Have compassion. God had compassion on you. Now you got a little Bible. Now you know some scriptures. Now you know where have you come from. What about when you couldn't sit yourself down? What about when you were promiscuous? We forget where we came from. He kissed him before the confession.
Yes.
I love that part of that. He kissed him before the confession.
Yes.
When he said, I'm no longer, no. You will always be my son.
Yes.
He gave his identity back, his dignity back. He redressed him.
Yes.
Then he gave him his authority back.
Yes.
You still have privileges as my son.
Yes.
Isn't that just like God? We messed up and we still have privileges.
Yes.
He covers us anyway.
Yes.
Father, we thank you.
Yes.
We bless you today.
We come in.
never gonna rock me again. I turned to the wall and started praying.
Call upon your name.
touch, touch right now in the name of Jesus. Somebody needs that breakthrough. Somebody's been praying for a prodigal son. Somebody's been praying for their daughter. Today I believe that, Father, under the anointing of God, you can touch them right now in the name, wherever they might be, God. Now, Father, we've been talking about walking in the supernatural. It's when you get into it, God. It's when you, something that could not happen, you make it happen, God. We thank you, God. With men, things are impossible, but you, all things are possible. And Father, I pray that today, that breakthrough is here. And I pray in the name of Jesus, as we take off these masks, I put my image down today, and I just say, God, I need you. I need a touch, I need a healing, I need a deliverance, I need a breakthrough, I need to be happy with me, God. I need to have peace in my own mind. I'm tired of fighting against me. So today, God, move by your power. People say I look good on the outside, but they don't know I'm hurting on the inside. Today, God, touch me in the inside today. Blow my mind.
service hour. It's like the man of God has told me the rest of the week, confirmation of what God has already told me. I mean, I struggle so much. God told me, I want you to use, I just want you to talk from the heart for these next months. I want to talk through you.
Yes.
And sometimes we try to rely on our own self, but we got to let God have his way.
Yes.
And so sometimes when you shift, Keith just reminded me when God woke me up, he said, this is a miracle, deliverance, breakthrough service.
Yes.
And that's what this church is founded on.
Yes.
Miracle. Deliverance.
Yeah,
we don't have no identity crisis. I know what God called us to do. Now others can do what they want to do. This is a healing, deliverance, miracle atmosphere that God has created in this house. And I believe that healing and deliverance goes for. But listen, last thing I want to do, I want to take a moment. Yesterday, I did a funeral yesterday. My son is in here, and my spirit was so sensitive. Buried this 16-year-old girl. I think she's a 16-year-old girl yesterday. And I got ready to close that casket. And God said, the enemy meant it for that, but God said, I turned it. Sometimes I want every young person to hear me. You can be at the wrong place at the wrong time. And the enemy can do some things. She was at a party, and they were having a good time, and somebody started shooting. And she took out running out of the party, and her friend was in the car, and she was driving, and her friend ran over and killed her.
Oh my God.
I'm going to pray for that mother and father this morning. I was praying for the father yesterday. He just grabbed me so tight. And I told him, I said, I know it hurts, but God is going to do something for you. It's going to give you that peace. So can you lift your hands up for a moment? Father, in the name of Jesus, I don't just pray for my brother, but I pray for every bereaved family that's waking up this morning with hurt and pain, with a void, right in the name of Jesus. Touch right now. Touch that mother. Touch that father. Touch her sister. Touch her brother. Touch all of her friends. So, Father, I pray in the name of Jesus. I pray a special prayer over our kids. Cover them with your blood. And, Father, even though they're growing up and they're doing things that sometimes they don't even know that the enemy is trying to take their lives. So Father, would you put a protection? We plead the blood that will not fall from the tree before that time. I pray for that hedge of protection this morning. And I pray in the name of Jesus, my daughters, I pray for that covering. I pray that, Father, I pray that my heart would always be right toward them. And I pray no matter what I feel, no matter what I see, I know what you told me. So Father, I pray that, Father, today as we give it all to you, God. We stand and receive it. I pray your blessings. I pray for your increase. I pray for your healing. I pray for your deliverance. I pray for breakthrough. I pray that you redirect, reconnect, and reposition our kids today. Prayer be done. In the powerful name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. Come on, give God a hand clap and pray. Father's Day to all the fathers. Amen. Amen. The Bible says bring all the tithes and storehouses, and let your resources and laws improve me and see God. I go up the roof of heaven and pour our blessings from our blood and see the promise and root to devour for our sins. Now, Father, I pray that every seed is given today. I'm this anointing, God. I pray that you have a breakthrough seed today. I want you to write on your envelopes a breakthrough. Breakthrough. A breakthrough seed coming. Breakthrough seed coming. Breakthrough seed coming. Hallelujah. stand to our feet? Hold your seeds just like this. Father, in the name of Jesus, we hold our seeds up to you, Father, as they leave our hand, they will never leave our life. Now, Father, we pray for a blessing that would overtake us. You said at a time there that we could command the windows to be open. You said you would pour us our blessing on our Lord to receive. You promised to rebuke and devour. Father, I thank you that wealth and riches will be in our house. You said money answered everything. I pray for debt cancellation. Now, Father, I pray as we release it, God, you're going to get back to us, God. Overflow. I pray blow our mind. Unscheduled shit. I pray things are going to hit our mailbox that we never thought. I pray for a new positioning, God. I pray for raises and increase. I pray that lawsuits are going to be settled. I pray that, Father, you will blow our minds. It's in the powerful name of Jesus Christ we pray. Amen. All the millionaires, make some noise. You're gonna be in a whole different place. I see you traveling. I see you moving. I see things happening for you. And God is going to be with you. The next chapter of your life is going to be great. And God say for you to go home. So John, right there. What do you want? Be specific about what you want. And if you stay connected to God, always honor him, everything you write on that paper will come to pass. That's what God just told me to tell you. So I want you to be devoted. Amen.
For coming here on today. God bless. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. To everyone, thank you again for joining us for our Miracle Sunday, our Father's Day. Amen. And we pray that you continue to support the palace publicly and virtually in service and help us get the word out by clicking, share, like, and for commenting. Thank you for doing that during the worship experience. Every Sunday here via Facebook Live. At our locations, Palace of Praise Church, Spring, Texas, right here. Amen. And Palace of Praise Church, Cleveland. They've started their service at 12 noon. Amen. For those of you who wish to become a member of the Palace of Praise, text JOIN to 281-688-2268. Or you can email us at thepalacecares@yahoo.com. Or you can just come forth. Amen. And you can become a member of this great church. For those of you, 681-688-6011, and you're going to text GIVE for that. PayPal.me/praise121. Cash App, $PopPalaceNation. And you can send it to our business office, 117 West Hamilton Street, that is in Houston, Texas, 77076. Amen. And we thank God for that. Amen. Our weekly services, remember to tune in on Wednesday night, Word Wednesday, via Facebook Live, where we will be giving a special word by none other than our pastor, Pastor Easy McDuffie. And when you log on, amen, you say hi to him, and I guarantee you, he will say hi back to you. And if you have family members or friends, and they don't have Facebook, we do rebroadcast on our YouTube page, Pop Palace Nation, as well as Pop Palace Nation Cleveland. And don't forget to click subscribe. If you are in need of prayer, we offer a prayer call here straight from the palace. Monday through Saturday, it starts at 6 a.m. until, and the prayer line number is 302-202-1108. The access PIN is 698-504. But this information is also listed on our Facebook page. On Thursday, high noon, amen, we have noonday prayer. We have Facebook Live with our very own assistant, Pastor William and Lady Freelo on our Spring, Texas page. Then each Thursday night, please join our Cleveland campus pastors as they host their Thursday night prayer. Do you want to know what's going on at the palace? Of course you do. So I will tell you. We are having an upcoming picnic on July 2nd. Amen. And out in front, I've already spoken with some of you. We have a form for volunteers. And many of you volunteer will be calling because we're going to prepare some of our special sides for that. Maybe even have a competition because we do have trophies. We shall see. But we are asking you to go sign in at the after service is over, as well as for those of you for baptism. We already have some of you on the list, but there is another list outside. Should you like to be baptized, amen, please sign that list as well. And thank you so very much. Thank you that you wanted to know what was going on here at the palace. Also, I have to bring the children in it. I told you how the kids, they go forth in children's church. There's none other than Kyrie. Kyrie goes forth in children's church. So Pastor McDuffie, Kyrie idolizes you. So when Pastor is preaching and we can hear all the noise, Kyrie, turn the TV on. And we turn the TV on and he's looking Pastor up and down, up and down. So in children's church, when there's something going on, Kyrie says, let me pray for him. So he would take his hands and put them on him, and then he goes like this and he'll say, amen, amen. Okay, now some no more. I said, well, Jesus is my friend. And he says, all right. And look at the heart of a little child.
Yeah.
That's what I love about our children. Okay, so while we continue to pray for your safety and believe that God is our provider and he is in control, the palace wants you to know that we're there for you. If you're in need of help, call 281-288-7520. Now, the palace has this thing. Oh my gosh, it isn't over, fathers. It is not over on today. So, Pastor.
We want the oldest father to stand up. Amen. If you are 60 and above, I want you to stand. If you are 65 and above, stay standing.
At all who can, please come out and be a support. Amen? Remember, we're going to be in prayer. Prayer changes things. Prayer changes people. Also, remember, Saturday morning, we have prayer here at 6 o'clock at the church. Please come. Come one, come all. Remember, please be in prayer for our pastor. Happy Father's Day again to Pastor Easy McDuffie.
As Pastor was praying for Keith, brought it up, my mind went back. Way back. A lot of people don't know me and Keith. We ran the streets, we ran them all. And Keith McDuffie, thank you. The reason why I'm back in church is behind him. And I know I play a part in his life. Now, I was going through a situation. I could have went and did whatever I wanted to do. But he opened his arm and embraced me. And not only me, my girls. As time went on, different situations, keep went through a stroke, but go ahead and there. And now I understand why we came back together. The Spirit told me to tell you, Keith, every experience and encounter that you went through was necessary for you today. For your humbleness, your sincerity. And he's saying, well done. So I'm going to keep playing with you, brother. I love you. And I'll never leave you, sir.
Amen. 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 I have a wonderful, wonderful, wonderful evening. Amen.